Is there a Flora man in your home? Flora, the margarine for men.
And now, City. This film is a very frank look at professional football, and it contains emotional moments where strong language is naturally used.
To put it in a nutshell, I've seen Tony and Malcolm about an hour and a half ago. We talked about the club's position, and I put it to them, asked them to, if they'd like to, I don't think likes the word, but if they'd resign from the position of manager and coach, and that's what they've done.
Go on, just a quick first of all, the City team, the
John Bond's been offered the position of manager of Manchester City, which he's accepted. The only problem, slight problem we've got, which I'll be dealing with after we finish here, is the question of compensation with his club.
This is the story of two men who were teammates in the 50s. On the left, Malcolm Allison, the teacher. On the right, John Bond, his pupil. 30 years later, their paths cross again at a famous football club. Manchester City have fallen on hard times. They haven't won a league game all season. In 2 years, over £8 million worth of players have come and gone, and now they're third from the bottom of the First Division. City fans are tired of being overshadowed by their more glamorous rivals, United. They want success, and in the 60s, Malcolm Allison provided it.
It's only just the First Division movement, now, it's just about a yard.
He coached an exciting City team to four major triumphs in 5 years. Now Big Mal's back. He's sold seven internationals and put his faith in the talents of these raw youngsters. Manchester City's chairman is Peter Swales. He's backed Malcolm for 18 months. A week ago, he was asked whether Allison was 1 minute from the sack. He didn't say no.
Now I want you to get at him right from the off. Right, just imagine you're one down. Imagine you're one down and play that way.
Today, City play league champions Liverpool. Malcolm went to his chairman to see where he stood. Peter Swales assured him he had his total support. But nobody knows for how long.
Because
it all comes from you anyway. You know, when we pushed in, you're the one who's got to come next, and then everybody.
I'll tell you what, you bring him right in, you can bring him right in front if you like. Yeah, but bring him, come right in. Not 10 yards. Right.
Tony Book has been at City for 15 years. He was bought as a player by Malcolm Allison, then made manager by Peter Swales. Now Book knows that if Malcolm goes, he goes too.
Right. I want to see your arms, I want to see. I'm really sharp. Because last week was the first time I've really seen you explode.
Mal's also got his team problems. Joe Corrigan, senior player and goalkeeper, has stated publicly that he didn't think Mal should have come back.
He comes right in like that, Kennedy, and he leaves that space. Tony, you just go wide as you like and go.
Go!
A little sunshine, a little autumn nip in the air, and Manchester City, lying 20th in the First Division, kick off against Liverpool, lying second. City attacking the goal to our left in this first half.
Nicky! Nicky! Back up! In there!
direct, but that's academic. It's all of 50 yards from goal, I guess. Kennedy back to Cohen. Dalglish, never quite sure which way he'll turn. And got it back onto his left foot. It's always the danger. Manufactured by Kenny Dalglish out of absolutely nothing. Jinked one way, turned the other, doubled back, and the left foot did the rest. Cohen plays it in. Now he jinked to go to one side, then to the other. Now he comes back again, he's lost Caton, and the ball is in at the post.
Half time. Peter Swales retreats to the director's private lounge. Downstairs, there's no rest for the players. Malcolm has them back in the gym.
Push Tony in there, push him in there. You know, as soon as it's in front, you know, you see the situation.
Around all the time.
Turn it up a bit.
Liverpool are leading 1-0, but it needed all the individual brilliance of Kenny Dalglish to break the stalemate. Dalglish took a pass to Cohen on the edge of the penalty area, with him back to goal and Caton on his heel.
Where's Tony? Tony! Try and make more distance on your runs. Yeah. Now, when you're there, make distance on your right. He don't want to run, Kenny. Yeah. When you, as soon as you get away, accelerate.
Yeah. I'm going down, John.
Again, City closing down the space of the man on the ball. But that man was Dalglish, and he found McDermott. McDermott crosses, and Souness has got another goal. He just can't stop. He's delighted. It's now 2-0. Graham Souness.
16 minutes gone in this second half. Liverpool in complete control, leading by 2-0.
Dalglish for Lee. Five of them in this break. Lee tries the shot, and what a shot it was too! Beaten by the pace of the shot from Sammy Lee. 3-0 the scoreline, and Manchester City are sunk.
Hudson, A-G-N-S-E-N, Clemens, 6. Cohen, C-O-H-E-N, 6.
Added the final nail in City's coffin.
Joe Corrigan let in 3 goals. Malcolm thought he should have saved at least one.
It's a bad goal. He's not gone in the net about 2 miles an hour. How can that be a good goal? It's 20-odd yards.
I see what your point. We're looking at it from the other point of view.
You're looking at it. You're dreaming up miracles. You're saying he did this, he did it. He turned. He made a little chance and he had a shot. And it's gone like that and it's gone in the net. If it had been anybody else, you wouldn't even mention it.
Well, not many players who can do that.
What? Make the ball bounce.
Yeah, sure that. Sure the Julie can do that. Yeah, anyway, we're very different on that one.
The third goal was a good goal. That is a good goal, the third goal. Good goal, fuck me.
The bounce will bounce off your arm. The wheel thought it was a funny Dalglish kind of goal, you know, brilliant goal. He's made it from nothing, nothing else. Malcolm doesn't really think so.
Got the double up, Malcolm.
Okay.
You've got the double up, wasn't Palace at the bottom. Not putting pressure on, you know, this is a quiet little private meeting.
I mean, nobody has to put pressure on me, because there's enough.
Don't you think we ought to, are we going to stick with these we've got or what? Do you know what I think, really? And do you think, what do you think about this one? You won't like this one. Do you know what I think could do well
for us? Don't tell me the answers to my question.
No, I won't tell you the answer. Do you know what I think could do well for us now? He won't do it because I've suggested it, but do you know what I think could do well?
No.
The fellow we let go.
Watson?
No.
Who?
You're thinking of Ace,
though?
Yeah.
Who? Ace is thinking of.
Do me a favour. See, that's all you like.
Sparring between Malcolm Allison and Peter Swales often drags on for hours after another defeat. Tonight, City are second bottom of the league, one game nearer the second division. But Mal still believes he has his chairman's promise of more time.
We had an agreement, the chairman and I, haven't we?
He's just going to leave me to get on with the job. I mean, you're talking about one of the best teams in the world today. You know, as a unit, their combination of play and their understanding is tremendous. And yet we, you know, we stretched them a few times today. Really stretched them. And you go and see them play against other teams, and the other teams, all they have to do is defend against them. Bring 10 back, 9 back, and just defend against them. If my team's going to learn, they've got to learn to play these teams.
Big Mel's better known publicly for champagne and cigars than for his controversial coaching. His reputation for bringing on individual players is second to none. He sees himself more as a teacher than a manager. He can't resist any new idea. He's tried dancing teachers, psychiatrists, university lecturers, and now he's planning music in the dressing room. As a player, he was known as the master of the West Ham Academy until his career was cut short when he lost a lung. Now he's 53, he goes on inventing elaborate tactics, but they're not always understood.
Mac is 20 yards behind me.
It doesn't make any difference. I mean, you see, he was the one who caused all the problems. If you win the ball off him there, if you win possession there, you're only 30 yards from goal.
But he wasn't going there and getting the ball. He was just dragging me in there and McDermott's coming off Macca.
But I mean, McDermott wasn't a problem. It wasn't a problem.
I'll tell you what, he went on about 5 runs and on his own.
I know he went on 5 runs, but still, Souness was the one who was the problem and caused us all the problems. I mean, it's no good you agreeing with me.
And I'm not agreeing with you, I think you're wrong.
No, but I mean, agreeing with you on Friday and then not doing it on Saturday.
Four days later, on a cold winter evening, City are away to Leeds United, who also hover near the bottom of the table. Malcolm has to win this game if he's to keep Peter Swale's support.
I said to him, I'll back you 100% in anything you want, which I did, of course, with cash and letting players go and bringing players in. And I said, I only want one thing off you. I don't expect you to win the championship because we'd already knew it's going to be a rebuilding job. The only thing I want off you is I don't want to be bottom of the league. And he said, you won't be at the bottom. And of course, at the end of this week, we could be at the bottom.
What I want to do is be outside and not let Joe be on the inside, let him be in the middle and you on the outside, so it's not going out.
What's your line? 6 yard line.
Right? All right, skip.
I want something to hang my hat on desperately out of these two games, you know, and if I could find the slightest excuse for prolonging it, I would do. If we lose the both games, I haven't got one.
Mikey, no.
It's tragic that we haven't had the results, really. Tragic.
And to go back to results, if you get negative results tonight and Saturday, what then?
It looks as if we'd have to make a change, yes. We'd have to try. If somebody else could, you know, give us the Midas touch again.
He's trying to think of losing it when you box. You know that thing we were doing yesterday? Monday, when the fella's marking you. You know, just when the player, just try and lose him that fraction of a second. Just show the player off and just lose him. Don't wait and see what's going to happen. Lose him. Stay, Paul, Paul. You're right, Paul, you're right, Paul. You're okay, son. Wait, Tommy, wait! Well, make him run, make the central striker run. A bit deeper and wider!
Half the game gone, and no score.
Tommy, when you're coming out, and it's a bit tight in front there, you know, you either play one over the top, just in the corner flags, just over the top, or you go for shot. All right? Go for your power. You play balls out when you come out there, and you know, when it gets cut out, that one got cut out there, got us banging trouble. You know, you try to play in there with about 10 players in there, all in and around the box. They've got to go to wide positions then.
You expected me to put you over the top, Kevin.
But you see, that ball's too tight, Tom. It's too easy for a defender, that ball, you know, knocked in there. Tony, you can play 20 yards off the touchline, but as soon as we win possession, get out to the touchline. Get out to the touchline. Be strong on that. Get out. You can't take it off yet. You can always come back when you get. If he comes in and closes you again, you can always check back again the second time. But the first time, come inside, then go outside. And then if he closes you, then come back inside.
I think the backman could run it further up because it's pointless me getting it on the halfway line because I'm doing exactly what they're doing.
All right.
If they run, then you commit.
Yeah, will you go away?
They're running away.
Well, that's it. Well, we're taking it up.
Right. You're not going far enough because you can get right in their last third. And then you can play me, I'm free there, and we're in for a fucking shot. But it's no point in me coming back there, because it's the same for you. It's you and me, I'll
come back here.
Yeah, well, what I'm saying is, we've got to get forward then, because I'm in fucking limbo land. Fuck all right.
I'm Tony, when he's got the ball, make that angle so wide, you know, go out really wide for him. Because he's fucking, you know, he's slapping loose balls again, isn't you? Going in the touch. When he's in that position, you know, that's all you've got to do. But you've got to make that angle so safe for him, it's not true. And then we can go and we can play from there.
Oh, Tony!
Tony, go in!
Leeds score, the only goal of the match.
In our box. I keep telling you, keep trying to play those balls in there. Get you killed, son, in the middle of the park. Get you killed. That position you come in behind Tommy Booth, Tony. That position you come in behind Tommy Booth. If you'd come in a wide position, it'd have dropped to you. Wanting to be in there too early, everybody wants to be in there too early. Panic stakes, they all panic.
The next day, Peter Swales calls a news conference. Malcolm Allison stays away.
Well, gents, it's something's obviously going on, isn't it? To put it in a nutshell, I've seen Tony and Malcolm about 2 hours ago, was it?
An hour and a half ago.
We talked about the club's position and I put it to them, ask them too, if they'd like to, I don't think like's the word, but if they'd resign from the position of manager and coach, and that's what they've done. The situation will be, the situation is that I've asked Tony to hang on for the West Brom game, and he'll be looking after that with Ken Barnes on Saturday. Do you want to add anything to that?
No, we accepted the chairman's views.
So you've got to understand.
Can I come in there, Chairman? To be fair to the chairman, Mark and myself always knew where we stood.
I'm not trying to get myself off the hook there. Tony made that statement, not me.
Well, the situation, gents, which you, obviously you know what's happened, and we're not here to discuss whether you think it's right or wrong. I mean, all I've got to say on that subject is that I don't think I had much choice, really. But that's as it may be. The situation is that Tony will be and Ken Barnes will be with you tomorrow for the West Brom game. And I hope to get somebody, a new manager appointed pretty quickly. And, you know, I want to really say to you is, whatever you think about this decision, whether you personally think it's the right thing to have done or the wrong thing to have done, you know, you've still got a job to do. We've got a job to do here, and that's to stay in the First Division. And I know you lot can do it. That's all I require from you. Any questions?
To me, it's a very, very sad day. I thought the joy was just coming, you know, it's just developing now. And I was going to get some of the pleasure. And I'm not going to get any of the pleasure. Maybe some, maybe I'll see they do well in the future and I'll be pleased and it will please me. I would have gone to the end of this season. But he wouldn't have had to tell me. I'd have told him. If I couldn't see any light and I couldn't see any progress and I couldn't see that I was getting anywhere, yeah, I'd have told him. I'd have said, look, I'm not going to make it. I'm not doing it. But I know that I was on the right lines. I know that it was going to happen. And that's what's hurting me. Most important book I've ever read is The Master Game by Robert E. Ropp, an American. And he talks about the games of life. He talks about the war games, the money games. You know, he calls them the pigs in the trough. He talks about the association, the games of life with man and woman. But the most important thing in the book to me was he said the most dangerous thing any person can have is an ego. And when I read it, I realised, you know, he was absolutely correct.
But aren't you famous throughout the land as having a massive ego?
You know, people think so, but I couldn't be sitting here talking to you if I had a massive ego at the moment, because I've just been sacked from my job means that I'm incompetent in my job. And if I had an ego, that would be the most destructive thing, and therefore, you know, no way I could handle this situation. I know that in the future I'm going to look at this team, some of these players, and admire them. They got lots of character, and they will do well. And I'll be very pleased for them. I've never worked with a better bunch of players. Never.
I'd just like to thank you all for all the hard work. And I'm sure that you'll be successful in the future. So I'd just like to say cheerio to you. See you, Tom. Cheers, Cass. Moments.
Our best, man.
Mickey. See you, Roger. Look after yourself. Tom. Keep working. Stevie. Look after yourself. Sad. Cheers, Tony. Don't forget, on the outside. Relax,
man. All the best, man.
Been a good skipper.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
All the best, man. All the best, Mel. Wish you every success, whatever you do.
Cheers, Kev. David. Don't forget what I said to you about fucking fighting off them injuries. Cheers, David. Good luck, Stevie.
Cheers.
And work hard, eh?
Yeah.
Kerry, work hard, yeah?
All the best, man.
Cheers. Cheers, Step.
All the best, man.
Bye-bye. Clive, work hard in that turn. Cheers, Andy. See you.
Didn't ever get it put you. Look after yourself, Jed. Alex, work hard, eh?
All the best, mate.
Cheers, Noel. Big fella. All the best. Thanks, man. Cheers, Keith. Cheers. Look after yourself.
Thanks, Ben. All the best, mate.
Okay.
All the best, mate. Look after yourself. All the best, yourself.
Sorry.
See you, Joe. See you.
Staff is a cigar from the makers of Hamlet. It's quite a bit bigger than a Hamlet, a bit more tightly packed, and a bit slower burning, which means it lasts a bit longer than you think. Sometimes quite a bit longer. Falstaff, a surprisingly long smoke for its size.
Now experience the sheer beauty of the most exciting window system ever developed. AstraSeal in brilliant white PVC. AstraSeal. Tailor-made for a perfect draft-free fit and designed to open two ways, for ventilation and easy cleaning. The sealed unit double glazing keeps all the elements out and all the comfort in. Fit AstraSeal, the window that's white years ahead.
We don't ask you to lock up your money for years to get a high return. Bradford & Bingley's new extra interest account unlocks it any time. Currently, after only 1 year, you get 10% interest.
You can take all sorts of things to relieve coughing. Here's one little thing you can take with you. Fenning's Little Healers. Tiny, easy to carry and very, very effective. To ease congestion and coughing, take Fenning's Little Healers wherever you are.
Well, that's us, I suppose. Well, bye, Dad.
Bye, son.
Look after yourself.
Come on, you two. Come on, come on.
Look after her for us. Keep in touch now. Do you hear?
When you've a phone, miles don't matter at all. And it doesn't cost much to keep in touch.
The flavor's great if you fry or bake. It's British bacon. So taste it, savour it. It'll be your flavouring, tasty British bacon.
British bacon. Everybody's favourite. Buy it where you see this sign.
For 2 days, the press have speculated over the name of City's new manager. The clear favourite is John Bond from Norwich City. City chairman Peter Swales has telephoned Norwich City's Sir Arthur South. South wants £200,000 compensation for Bond because his contract still has 6 years to run. But he gave Swales permission to approach his manager. Bond wants the job. He comes to Manchester to meet the board.
My question has always been to you. Who is the man, the genius, who's the god that could take over Malcolm's role here?
One of the qualities of a manager, apart from knowledge of football and ability to coach, is man management, and perhaps I should say boy management.
Sydney, you've got John Bond's got his son in the side. I mean, you can't have gone through a more testing period, surely, with a young player coming through. And people saying he's no good at certain stages, I've heard John Bond say that himself.
John Bond may indeed be the man we want. I'm just raising the point that we ought to know a little bit more about his ability and what his attitude is, and that can only come out in interview.
Do you realise how serious the position is here?
Yeah.
And that we're very... It's quite a fair bet that we can get relegated.
Yeah, I'm terribly aware of the position. Don't you have any fears about that? Because, I mean, if I come here and if I sign on for this as manager of this football club, I know it's a mammoth task, and I know the needs of you gents around this table, and I also know the needs of the supporters who come and pay the monies to watch the team week in and week out.
Because it's not Norwich City, like, you know, we're... I think we're in the big time.
I think you're in the big time. That's why I want to be manager of the place. And without any conceit, I don't think you'd have asked me up here today if I hadn't have got some ability. And I think I have the ability to lift your side and give it this certain amount of confidence and maybe a little bit more determination to go on and win a few games.
What sort of order would you tackle the job in? What would be the first thing you would do?
Well, I think the team overall has got to be realise that it's got to be terribly disciplined now. I ain't going to have people who are going about and excuse your expression, pissing about and sort of flouting the image of Manchester City about. I don't think that's right. You know, so if I feel that people are not,
I came prepared to be a little disillusioned, but I'm very impressed with him.
Yeah, that applies to you.
Definitely.
Ian?
No, I couldn't make an assumption on what's happened here in a quarter of an hour. I wouldn't give an opinion.
But you're not against it?
I've said before, I support the chairman of Manchester City, and I will support you in what you do. What I feel, I shall keep to myself.
Chris?
I'm very impressed with him. I think you've got a good fellow.
Yes.
Yes, very good.
He's not disappointed me.
Very good.
Leave it to the chairman and...
Point is for chairman.
I won't beat about the bush, Johnny. It's subject to, I've been at a sort of Norwich side out, compensation side, you know, we'd like to offer you the job.
Oh, that's very nice. We'd be pleased to accept it.
Peter Swales managed to halve the Norwich chairman's compensation demand and they agreed on £100,000. So John Bond left Norwich, but under a cloud. He took away with him his youth team manager and his chief coach, but left behind Norwich City's captain, his own son, Kevin. 3 days later, Bond arrives for his first meeting with the Manchester City players.
Morning.
Well, lads, I've just got you in here together today, just for a couple of minutes, for my sins or whichever. I'm going to be your new manager. I'll be decide how you and myself work together, how long I'm going to be here. And if you reason, he may tell you that I intend to be here for some considerable time. So, John Benson will be my assistant manager while I'm here. While you're here, I would like to think that you and I will know each other. I'll know you as the players and you'll know me as boss. I don't say that for any other reason for me to be the boss, because I want to be out there and you to be down there. But I think it's absolutely right, because I think that shows a mark of respect. I think that when we're in hotels and places like that, there'll be a few Johns about, and that's my name, John. And if you get in a hotel and shout out John, and I might think that's me, and I don't think that's right. So from now on in, when we're together, you know me as boss. I'm not here to slag off what other people have done before me. I'm not here to slag off Malcolm Allison. Whatever you thought about Malcolm Allison, I thought twice as much. I played with him for an awful long while. He was my best friend, still is my best friend, at West Ham for the years that we played together up there. So, as far as I'm concerned, he did a marvellous job, and I think, and I'm conceited enough to think, and that's why I'm in management, I'm just conceited enough to think that we can do better than what we've done. We have little forms of discipline if people misbehave and do things wrong. For instance, if you're late in training, you get fined. If you're late for the coach, you get fined. On match days, everybody, just everybody who comes to Main Road for a first team match will wear a collar and tie and a jacket. A coat or tops. You don't wear pullovers, you wear a collar and tie, and you wear either a jacket or a leather jacket. That will be done. If you don't do that, you'll be fine. The thing is about attitude. The thing is about having a good attitude of mind to the game. Don't you tell me you'll wake up Saturday mornings and you won't feel like playing. You'll feel a little bit indifferent. The thing is about your mind and your attitude of mind when you get out on that football field. I shall be pushing you, I shall be shoving you, I shall be demanding from you. Give it me, and with all the conceit in the world, I'll tell you, that you'll find me as good as anybody in the country in terms of looking after you. Don't do it, and you can be on your bike as quickly as that. I can't spell it out any quicker or any easier than that to you. I shall be looking and asking an awful lot from you from now on in.
When I was manager at Bournemouth and Ted McDougall was a player underneath of me, he said that I don't think you should ask players. There was times when I'd ask players certain things and he said, I don't think you should ask players what to do. He said, I think that you should tell them what to do, he says, and they respond far more readily to that sort of thing than they do if you ask them. And I think he's absolutely right. I think that they need to be disciplined, and if there is discipline about, I think that they like it. I think sometimes it cut across their path and they get a little bit sort of upset about it all, but basically they like the thing to be a disciplined, well-run sort of outfit, and it suits them far better.
Bond City won 10 out of the next 13 games. Everybody was arguing about where the magic had suddenly come from. Allison said Bond had only inherited his players who were bound to come good. Bond said he found the players confused when he arrived. He bought 4 experienced players to add to Malcolm's side, but 3 of them couldn't play in a League Cup tie. So here was John Bond's biggest test. Could Bond beat West Brom with Allison's team? To make it worse, City begin by giving away an own goal. City have made it.
Can you tell me, Ray Ranson, can you tell me, how old are you? 20. My son, you've got a lot of learning and learn quickly because the sooner you learn the better. We don't get free kicks late on, do we? And flip little balls into the middle of the field, boy, yeah? We hit space and say, well, sort it out from there. That's all you've got to do. We get balls down the flanks. Paul, you've got a ball and you pulled it inside and you finish up having to poke it inside with it and let it come straight across rather than just sod it. If we give the ball away in them situations, sod it. Make them turn and chase and get back. We can't, it's impossible. There's, is you, Dave, the young lad again learning, is you, you want to play football all the time. When you're under the cosh and you're under pressure, the worst thing that they hate to do is run back towards their fucking goal for the ball. So let's just learn little lessons. When you're in front, when you just before half time, just towards the end, when you're in front and things are going, you know, giving you a bit of just get it down in them corner flags and then just hold it and hold it and hold it. Take the pressure off yourselves, that's as simple as, you don't want to do anything stupid, what do you want to do silly things for? Overall, you were magnificent. You come back from an unfortunate goal and you fought and you did. I was proud of you. Well done.
You had some rather harsh words to say about the setup when you first came here, which people sort of took as direct criticism of Malcolm. And you seem to have put things right in a remarkably short time. Do you think perhaps on reflection you were a bit harsh?
Maybe I was a bit kind.
A bit kind.
If you just sort of harping back on what happened before I came here, I think maybe the one big problem and the one big thing that was never sort of sold was or done was to get some 2 or 3 experienced players in to make the Nicky Reeds and such people as that much better.
And I think that's maybe the crux of the matter.
What about the number four?
Nicky? Good little player.
Excellent.
Wants to win, you see. Wants to win. Malcolm's boy.
By now, Malcolm Allison is managing Crystal Palace for the second time.
This is the draw for the third round of the Football Association Challenge Cup.
Number 42.
West Ham United.
Number 44.
Against Wrexham.
Number 22.
Manchester City.
Number 13.
Against Crystal Palace.
Like the casting of a Hollywood movie, the two men are drawn together in the FA Cup. The old teacher is to meet his pupil. Malcolm has said that Bond hadn't achieved anything in 12 years. Now Allison is coming back, but to John Bond's main road.
It's nice from my point of view to be able to, in many ways, from Mal to be given me so much stick, because I know that over the years, whilst I got tremendous respect and regard for him, that I know that he looked at me as the sort of the worst part of the partnership between him, Campbell, and myself. He thought that I was the fellow who was least likely to succeed. In fact, I think if you really tied him down and ask him, that he ever thought that I would ever achieve anything. And I think that he thought I was a young country bumpkin who come up from the sticks and worked hard at his game but would never ever achieve too much in life. And I think that's the impression he always gave me. If he's going about now and thinking that I'm an opportunist by taking over something that he's left at Manchester City, he's vastly wrong. Briefly, I just want to just talk about what are we going to do today, and in terms of what Malcolm may be saying to them lads. I mean, all of a sudden you see all the little things that are going on in the press, and he says, I'm going to attack them on a weakness that I know about. I mean, that's all a load of crap, all of that. Don't make any mistake about that. I mean, he's trying to get you at it, and he's trying to say that make you wonder where he's going to attack you or what he's going to do during the course of the match. So that's all hullabaloo and all sort of psychologically trying to get through to you. So don't worry about that. When he was here and he was manager over the players who were here under him, he knew your strengths, he knew what good players you are, and if you play up to the ability that you've been playing recently, you ain't got nothing to worry about. You don't worry about what he says and the things that have been quoted in press and the things that he may be saying in that other dressing room.
Nicky Reid, he'll bomb out from the back. He'll bomb out, he'll pick it up and he'll go, shh.
What he might do is to play a spare man, and he might just put people tight onto Kevin Reeves, onto Phil Boyer, and onto Tommy Hutch.
When we got the free kicks and when we got the corner, you know, make sure that everybody's in position. Make sure, you know, plenty of time, but plenty of patience, no rush, get the positions right, bomb.
As long as your attitude is absolutely how it's been in the last few weeks, then that is all that matters. You'll go out there and you have to fear nobody.
It's very strange when I was coming to the ground. I had no feelings about the game. I just had a sense of pleasure about it. I was going to enjoy it. But I need to win badly. I need to win.
And what atmosphere at Main Road as Crystal Palace in the all-white strip with the diagonal band kick off in this first half.
Go on, Stevie Lovell! Stevie Lovell! Go forward, Stephen Lovell!
Whistle goes with the score sheet blank. At the moment it stands Manchester City 0, Crystal Palace 0.
Stephen, what I'm saying to you about getting forward is when we got possession and we're coming out, I want you to make a run. Not just, you mean a great run with the ball, but I want you to, when we're coming out with the ball and we get coming into midfield, I want you to steam right in beyond the front players. Beyond the front players, okay? That's what I'm talking about, and then you can have a breather. We need one break, and we'll beat them. One free kick around the box, and we'll score.
Clips that one well. Still Boyer beaten in the air. McKenzie tries the shot. Boyer was in fast. And the referee has given a penalty for an elbow on Boyer. Chance in the 9th, 10th minute of the second half to break the deadlock. Reeves against Fry. 1-0.
Didn't particularly put it together today. How we can put it together, did we? In fairness, we didn't knock the ball about. We started off all right, and we didn't. But you battled,
You don't do many silly things. There was too many from my point of view, and I know from yours, and you know, I know you want me to stop you from doing them. At the back, just at late on, we got involved in one or two little silly things. At the front, we was taking a little bit of liberties with the game. The name of the game is to impose your superiority, your extra ability, your extra skill on them. It's magic to see, like, Phil Boyer and Jerry Gale, for instance. I mean, it can be somebody else the next time, but they didn't actually have a particularly good game. There were too many wrong things up. But, and that marvellous to see them battling and working and grafting. You're getting no cover, you see, from the fullback in them situations. And you're too...
Well done, Mel.
Well done, mate. Just pull off and then you're in business. When they've got the ball halfway inside of their half and you've got two to two up the front and one of you just pull off, and that's a job.
I think if you could get somebody who was big enough to control him and run him and be connected with him, I think that you could be really, really successful. But I tell you what, you have to really have somebody who would control him, because there is absolutely no doubts he has the capacity and the ability to make players better. I'm not sure, honestly and truthfully, whether he has the capacity to make teams better if he has the ultimate control. I mean, you only have to look at him. You only have to, he frightens people when he walks into situations.
Does he frighten you?
No, he used to. He used to, but I've long since known him, haven't I? I've stood up to him, you see. And that was one of the big reasons that I got on with him. I took almighty stick from him in certain situations. He belittled me, he kept me there. But at the end of the day, I've never had other than respect for him. I'll always like the fella. I'll always love the fella. He's a magic. He's a magic, magic fella.
I found that fella that controlled me. That's me.
I just happen to think that I could work with him. I don't think that will ever materialise.
You could work with him.
Yeah, I could.
I'd tell you what, there's no chance of you two working together.
I'd fight him and bite him.
No, it wouldn't work.
All right. So you might
have less chance than I had.
You may be right. But I just happen to think that way.
Would you wouldn't like to see the two of them work together?
No, that's an impossible situation. I mean, having seen them both, it wouldn't. There's no way that'd work. Absolutely none at all. I'd give that less chance than Abbott and Costello running a football club.
After 55 days at Crystal Palace, Malcolm Allison was sacked again. Meanwhile, John Bond turned City's sights to Wembley.
You were terrible.
It was dire.